So this talk is about something called test resource, which is a polymorphic memory resource. How many of you have been at John's talk just now? Hands up, one, two, three, so not many, okay. This thing is proposed for the ISO C++ standard library fundamentals, TS3. How many of you knows what is a TS? What does it do, hands up? So yeah, it's a technical specification. It's sort of a beta test for things that it says basically that we seriously consider adding something into the standard library. Please take a good look at it and give us feedback. So about me, my name is Attila Fehér, Attila Farkas Fehér. You might know me as White Wolf from the internet, because I normally use that name because people cannot remember my name, English-speaking people. And yeah, there are some more information that are not so important. And about the talk, this is my first time speaking at a public conference, so please forgive me for any stumbling. I'm presenting someone else's idea. So it is possible to ask me questions that I will not know the answer for right away, but the guy who knows it sits there, so I will just use him as a backup. And we will see a lots of slides, a lots of animations and stuff. So my request is that please ask your questions that are necessary to understand what is on the slides right away, so that you don't get lost. But if you have questions that are more like discussions or comments or going into tangents, let's wait with those until we finished and we understand the whole concept and the whole thing. And you can see right down there at the bottom of the slide, you can see the slide number, number 3 there. So you can write down the slide number. We can always go back at the end to slides. So what topics? Introduction, just saying what I will talk about, purpose, why we did this test resource. We will look a little bit at how the PMR system works in the standard library of C++ 17. The biggest part is this number 4, where I will be showing lots of code. Then we will very quickly look at when the test resource can be useful. Enhancement ideas, why? Basically what we did is that we have written a proposal to the C++ Standardization Committee that had the minimal necessary changes to make it something that can that people are willing to look at. So that we changed it to work with the PMR system, not with our allocator system. And we removed macros from it and stuff like this. But we did not change it so that we can actually present that exactly what we have been used for 20 years, for what we have field experience with. But we have ourselves ideas of how to make it more modern and how to make it more capable, which we expect that many of those will be applied to it before it would get into like a technical specification or something like that, because C++ committee never accepted anything unchanged. So if we have time, we will look at the code, which will be interesting because we have no internet absolutely in this room. So we have a copy of the code on my computer, but okay, so introduction. This is from a colleague of mine, Alistair. He wanted to very clearly specify what we will be talking about. So please read it to yourself. Basically, we are showing something that can tell you stuff about allocation, which we can call telemetry or instrumentation, and it can look for leaks and other nasty things that can happen in badly written code. And it is a polymorphic memory resource, and because it's a polymorphic memory resource, it plugs into allocators. we have the proposal for it, as I mentioned earlier, and the code is freely available on GitHub. So if you want to try it out, you can do that today. It is under a very, very forgiving, or how should I say, very, very open license as well. Another thing, this talk is not trying to sell polymorphic memory resources. That's what John did half an hour ago. I aim to introduce this test resource and to make you understand what it can do for you in your daily work, if you can use it. So that's the code. I'm going to add this tag today to the GitHub when I get to a point where there is actually internet access. The purpose. So what can we do with the test resource? We can check whether the code we are testing leaks. We can check whether we are trying to use memory that we have released because it overrides the memory, but that's not such a big deal because most compilers in certain modes already do that. But it was a big deal 20 years ago. Do we write more bytes than we allocated, buffer overrun? Do we write before the bytes that we allocated? That's also possible. That's the buffer underrun. Do we deallocate stuff like a pointer with different values, because we will later see that the resources get the size and the alignment parameters also on the allocation. Probably something funny is going on in your code if you say that I allocated an int and I deallocate a double, right? Something funny is going on, so you want to know about it. And this is a very big point. This, do we cleanly survive a memory allocation failure? This is something that out of these many things that we listed is a test that basically it's almost impossible to do with an external tool. So what did we design test resource for? It verifies and instruments memory allocation related behavior. Verifies means what we just listed, leaks and overruns, underruns, and so on, double deletes and things like this. Instruments means that there are counters. We will see later what exactly those counters are. We made this especially for unit testing. Doesn't mean that you cannot use it outside of unit testing, but it has been designed especially for unit testing. So it makes our tests repeatable, automatable, so that you don't need a human to read through a log file to figure out whether it passed or not. Non-intrusive. We don't even need the source code that we are testing. As John pointed out in his talk, if we are using PMR, we don't have to have templates. If we don't have to have templates, we might get code in a library with a header, and we can still test it. It's targeted on individual objects. So unlike external tools, I can tell which part of the system I want to test, and I will not get false positives on CRT startup code and all those other things. And some people misunderstand because it says the word test in its name. It's not a test framework. We are not proposing a unit test framework, and that's not what we are talking about. It's something that can be integrated into any test framework that you are using. Yes?
Maybe you want to explain that the test allocator is a kind of allocator just like any other kind of allocator.
Yes, it's basically a PMR memory, polymorphic memory resource, and we will see very shortly how actually it looks like. What can we instrument? We can check, so basically what counters do we have in a way? How many blocks or bytes are allocated right now? So we have two of these measurements. How many were allocated in total? That's a running number. It always goes up, 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 up. That's the sum. The maximum of blocks and bytes ever allocated, they don't need to come from the same time. So I might have the maximum blocks 1 million and the maximum bytes 1 million, but they are coming from completely different situations. Last allocation and deallocation values, which might be interesting, that when you are testing something that actually gives you back like a container that gives you back an object, and you want to see that that object is actually within the last allocation, its address. And we have monitoring, which means that we can create a monitor class that from the points of its creation or its last reset, it monitors changes in these numbers. We will see that in code example later. And these are the names that are currently attached to those values, but they will most probably change during standardization. And here you can see the blocks, basically that you see everywhere on the. Let's show it this way. So blocks is, it means the allocation. So whatever one allocation returns is a block. So polymorphic memory resource recap. Let's just look at how polymorphic memory resource works. First of all, what is a polymorphic memory resource? It's just something that can allocate bytes and then release them. That's it. And it's actually modeled very simply. It's a virtual base class that has some functions that are not virtual, so it's a little bit confusing in that sense. But it can, as you can see, it can allocate and deallocate. We tell it bytes and an alignment. It doesn't talk anywhere about types of what it's allocating. It's allocating memory. It deals with memory. It has a little function that is called isEqual, which actually just tells whether this allocator, where the member function is, and that allocator, which is the other one, are they interoperable? Can they release each other's allocations? And then here are the virtual member functions that we were looking for. They are private, and they are the ones where the implementation is. So as you can see, implementing a polymorphic memory resource is very, very simple. The do is equal will be a very simple thing. It will either be only equal if it's the exact same object, usually, or it will be equal if the other object's dynamic type, so here we can use the dynamic cost, is the same as this object's dynamic type, and that's about it. The allocation and deallocation is the where the magic happens, and usually most people will never implement an allocator that actually allocates memory. That's a memory resource that actually allocates memory. Why? Because it will finally come from some place that already exists. So most probably the new delete memory resource that already exists in the standard library. And your memory resource is wrapped around it in a way. So when it needs memory, it goes to another memory resource. And this is this chaining that John was talking about that allows us to make these memory resources smarter and smarter. And I, for example, because of that reason, I can see that some people might want to take the test resource apart and have a resource that does the counting and have another resource that does the testing. We will see during standardization. So what happens in the headers of a standard library container is that we have a value type, and we have an allocator parameter, which is a template, as you can see. It's a template that takes the type T, and then we say we have a deck. Now, how does this match up with our polymorphic memory resource? For that, we have something called polymorphic allocator. This polymorphic allocator uses the name allocator because that indicates that this basically corresponds to the old C++11 concept of an allocator, which is a template, and it allocates a certain type. which I called here target. Maybe I could have used a better name. And a polymorphic allocator is actually based on a memory resource, and it stores that memory resource as a pointer. And if we just default construct it, then we get what is called the default resource, which is a kind of a global that we can change, which is the memory resource that every object is going to use unless we give it another one, another memory resource, in which case that gets stored. So basically, this is the mechanism that allows people to ignore polymorphic memory resources completely and polymorphic allocators, because if they don't give an argument to the function, to the constructor of an object, then it will just use this default resource, which is by default is the new delete resource, which is just calling new and delete. Then we have these two functions that allocate and deallocate, and as you can see, it does work with that particular type. So here comes, I don't know how many of you know about this rebind magic in the standard. Okay, not too many people, but basically if you think about containers, unless your container is a string or a vector, or maybe a deck, you are going to have to allocate something else and not the type that you are storing. So for example, a list needs to allocate a list node. Map needs to allocate a tree node, which will have pointers and whatnot inside. It will have a different size and so on. So out of the allocator to, let's say, int, we have to get to an allocator that can allocate our node. And that's the rebind magic, which creates an instance of a template, so an allocator for an int, an allocator for the node for an int, for example, for a list. And that's really an inconvenient thing. Polymorphic allocator also gives us access to the resource it's storing, and that's a very, very handy thing, because, as we said, because we can do that, if somebody gives us a polymorphic allocator, we can create another polymorphic allocator that is based on that one, and, for example, can count allocations. So it's a good thing that there is an access to that. So what we don't like about the polymorphic allocator that its interface is still only the old interface. So we can only talk to it about allocation and deallocation in the terms of the target type. And that's very inconvenient when you are writing code that is not using the C++11 way of dealing with allocators. So Pablo and Dietmar have created a proposal which is on its way to get into the standard, and that introduces polymorphic allocator, and you see here these empty angle brackets, where if you don't give it any type, then the type will be standard byte. And basically that's what we want. We want our allocator to allocate memory. It also adds additional member functions where I can say, please allocate for me this many bytes, or please allocate for me this many of that object. So we are actually talking about a member template. We will see those later. And basically those will help us so that we don't need to anymore use rebind, which we don't really like. And this whole thing is approved for C++ 20. It's nothing can stop it now. Yes? No, that was C++ 17 strategy. Maybe John knows. Pablo was the one mostly involved with the C++ 17 standardization. Probably they while they were making this type, they were thinking along the lines of how standard allocator looks like, and they wanted this allocator to look like any other allocator. so that they made it into a template so that generic code that looks at an allocator is...
No, I was asking why for the new functionality did they attach it to automatic allocator byte rather than to, you know, memory resource template or some non-template type.
That's what I'm saying, because the standard defines allocators to be templates so that you can rebind them and whatnot. And to not, because basically this works with the standard containers without the need to change a single line of the standard containers code. If this would not
that's
be...
the old functionality. I'm asking about the new functionality added, the additional member function of function templates to avoid having these rebinds. But we can go on and we'll talk about
it. Oh, that one? Yeah, I don't know. I think it's because this is the existing stuff. And they wanted to extend that. So basically, we can see here how the PMR containers come into existence. A normal container has two template parameters, at least. The type it stores and the allocator. And if we look at the one in the PMR namespace, which is template alias or alias template, it has only one argument, the allocator is gone, and it's basically baked in to be the polymorphic allocator of T. And that's it. There's nothing else. We didn't change vector, we didn't change deck. We just stuck in there another allocator.
And again, you change the default. PMR is simply changing the default allocator to be a PMR allocator.
Exactly. It bakes in the type of the allocator. Yes, David?
No, I'm in constexpr land.
Yes.
Is there any interest in having PMR allocators be constexpr?
That was coming into my mind while you were making your keynote, but I didn't want to, you know, go off on a tangent with a question like that. But that's something that we need to talk about. Yeah. Is there any use for polymorphic memory resources compile time?
If it's byte based, it cannot be done. But if it's type based,
well, the memory resource itself is basically void star.
Yeah, but we intercept. You know, for the context allocation, what we do is we intercept and we ignore the actual implementation. We just simulate.
Okay, we can talk about this offline. Yeah, this is an important thing. But any other question that is necessary for understanding the thing? Okay. So, what are the parts in this system? We will talk about these things in the code examples. So we have test memory resource, which is a class type. It implements a PMR memory resource. We have the monitor class type that we will see afterwards. We have the default resource guard, which is a very simple thing that just installs a default resource in its constructor and puts back the old one in its destructor. That's it. Not very interesting, but very useful. The test resource exception and an algorithm, they work together, and we will see that also in code examples. So let's look at the test memory resource first. And we are going to look at a broken string implementation. It's called pstring. People suggested to me while looking at the dry runs of this presentation that it's a presentation string. Well, in fact, it's a pathetic attempt at a string. So please don't ever write code like that. This is code that is full of bugs so that we can show you how the bugs are found by the test resource. But it's not anything that you would like to see in any code that gets close to. So first of all, this thing is not a template. So I'm making a normal little class. And I'm using this polymorphic allocator that works with bytes as an allocator. And this is kind of the canonical form of a constructor. that where you take the pointer to the here we take a pointer to a C string. So you take whatever you need to construct your type, and you take an allocator. And as you can see, that if we don't give an allocator, then we will get a default constructed one. And from the polymorphic allocator, which we are using, we saw a default constructed one goes and takes the currently set default, our magic global that people can change to something that they find better for their application if they wanted to. We have some more functions in here that are necessary for testing and whatnot. These examples, by the way, are all in the code on GitHub. So you will find this P string. This will be P string underscore stage one. We didn't define a destructor, so the compiler will generate a destructor for us, which does nothing. It's probably not a good thing because we are going to allocate memory for our string. We have to store the allocator, so later if we need to make the string bigger, then we know how to allocate. When we need to destroy it, we know how to deallocate. That's that pointer that John mentioned, this is our object size is bigger by size of a pointer. We store the length and we store a pointer to the buffer. That's it. It's that simple. So it's really a pathetic attempt at a string. It's not something that we would ever write. So here is our constructor. How do we implement it? We copy in the allocator into the, we know it's just a pointer, so we don't care about const references and stuff like that. We store the length of the string into the length member, and then we need to allocate memory for the buffer, and we use this new member from Dietmar and Pablo, allocate bytes, which will give us bytes. And we give the length and the number of bytes and the size of the alignment, which by definition for characters alignment is one. Does everybody know what alignment is? Okay, great. And of course, because this string is full of bugs, we don't allocate enough space for our string. So the moment we start to string copy the stuff in there, it's not a really nice thing that we are doing because we allocated n bytes and we will copy n plus one. So that's obviously an error that we would like the test resource to catch. How does the test code look like? We create a test resource. We give it a name so that when it prints something to the screen, then we know who printed it. Because with these things, we can have them one per if we want, we can have a separate test resource for each object. So we can have like 30 of them if we want to go crazy. But normally, you don't have more than like 3 of them. We have something that we call verbosity setting, which just tells whether it will print something for us on everything it does, or it will only print when there is an error. When we destroy this test resource, then it keeps track of its allocations, and then it will report leaks. We have something that will probably change during standardization. The way this test resource now reports failures that, for example, it detects in its destructor is that it simply calls abort. Because an aborted unit test is a unit test that has failed. So that works out. The issue is that we can do this better now with C++ 11, C++ 17. We have lambdas. We can tie this in nicer into the test framework. Why did we choose abort? Because it's not nice thing to throw an exception from a destructor. So there were not so many choices in C++ 98 at that time that were convenient to use. So because this is not a test driver for us now, this is not a unit test, we are just turning this off because this is just a demonstration and you don't want to have core files all over your computer or Windows popping up on Windows and macOS telling you that your program aborted. So we create a pathetic string, we give it something to store, and we give it the address of our test resource. And that point, we are testing it. Then normally in a when you are doing tests, you will have some sort of assert in there, some sort of test done that checks that your test statements actually did something. Because of course, for example, if this P string wouldn't do anything, this test would succeed. Yeah, there would be no leaks because it wouldn't do anything. So we actually check something, and but from our test point of view, it's just a sanity check. It's not so important. So what happens? The string is destroyed. It leaks because the destructor is compiler generated. Test resource detects the leak and reports. How does that look like? So when we run this in non-verbose mode, which means that it only reports the errors, then we will get this report. So we will see that somebody allocated something, one thing, number of blocks mean number of allocations. So there was one allocation which we did not release, and that had 6 bytes in it. Because our code is very simple, from this we know everything, but if the code is a little bit more difficult, then we probably want to rerun the test in verbose mode, which means that it's going to tell us when it allocates. And we can see allocated 6 bytes, align, pointer, everything is there. And there is a index number here. It starts from 0 and just goes up and up. It's a 64-bit number, which refers basically for this resource with the name string tr, which allocation it is. Then when the test resource is destroyed in verbose mode, it gives us a summary of its counters, basically, and we can see that there is still in use one block with 6 bytes, so that already shows us the leak. But what shows us the leak even better is this little thing that we would list. If we would have like 6 leaks, then it would list 6 indexes that we could match up with the indexes printed out. And afterwards, you fire up your debugger. You don't need to learn any GDB kung fu or anything like that. You just go in your debugger step. Okay, here is the code I'm starting to step into, and you are seeing the printouts, and you see exactly where allocation 0 happened, where allocation, I don't know, 12 happened that leaked, and so on. So it makes it easier to find find the leaks than it would be without it. And of course, we get still the error message as well, just doesn't fit nicely onto the slide. So we add the destructor to fix the leak. This slide is just here for my OCD. So we fix the leak, what happens? Well, in that case, the destructor is through some calls, gets to call the do deallocate function of this test resource, which will then do a lot more checkings, like was this allocated with the same size and the same alignment? Was this allocated by this allocator? Does it look like something that was allocated by a test allocator? Did I overwrite the memory somewhere? And so on and so on. It can do lots of checks, and it does so. So because we didn't allocate enough memory, we are going to overwrite memory, and we can see that it reports the memory corrupted 1 byte after the 6 bytes that we allocated. And we can see there is a lots of B1, 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 B1 here. And the first one is overwritten by a 0. That's the closing null character of the string. It will also report the header. We can see that this thing was deallocated on a Intel CPU. Little endian, so we have here dead beef that it starts with. That's the magic number that the allocator, our memory resource implementation writes into memory to figure out whether this thing belongs to it or not. It by it I mean the type. One of these many numbers is the address of the allocator itself, or the memory source itself, so it can check that it really was allocated by it. And then we have here the user segment is where the characters are. And as you can see, there are lots of B1s just before the user segment as well. So there is nothing very magical about this. And I'm pretty sure that many of you could come up with additional things that would maybe use a little bit more CPU, but would also be more fragile to detect. Because, for example, now if somebody overwrites stuff with B1, that we are not going to detect. So many of the things that we are doing is a best effort thing, because we are in, I was told not to use this word, but David will correct me if I'm using it wrong, but many times when we are trying to check stuff, here we are in undefined behavior land. So many things that we do, if the code is really, really broken, that is driving this test memory resource, it's going to have to do things on a best effort basis. We are going to talk about that a little bit later. So, yes?
I'm curious, 8 bytes padding up before and after? Is that some sort of all experience that's a good way to do it? But
Joe, that's the kind of, where do the 8 bytes come from?
It's pretty arbitrary, but think about it. What number would you pick? 7?
I just have no idea. I'm wondering did you try like several numbers and this one.
But think about it this way. I mean, you know, you don't have 1 byte, so 8 bytes is kind of like a word size.
Yeah.
If you go for more than that, what are the chances that you're going to have an overwrite that skips over the first 8 bytes and hits something later, but not so, you know, it's kind of one of those geometric things.
Right.
So if you're going to get an overrun, most likely you'll get an overrun that includes the approximate thing that had the first one. So 8 bytes is kind of arbitrary, but I don't see what kind of measurement you would do to prove that 16 bytes is better. Certainly 16 bytes is more expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, no, I don't know. That's
true.
So
by the way, that was written up in Appendix B of my first book in 1996, and I haven't rethought it since. So long time ago.
So for the for those folks who are on YouTube, the answer is that 8 is kind of arbitrary, but allocating even more memory, more additional memory is going to be more expensive, and there isn't much chance that additional, let's say, additional 8 bytes, so if you put there 16, will actually catch something that happened to skip the first 8 bytes. Not overwrite the first 8 bytes, but happens to overwrite, I don't know, byte 13.
Yes.
So that's just unlikely. This is a kind of best effort thing that worked for us, because most buffer overruns are not going to skip things. They are just going to go like a bulldozer going through all the bytes after the thing that was allocated.
Or if they don't, then they might jump and hit something, you know.
And if they don't, if they jump, then they might jump much bigger, like, for example, the whole size of the allocation, because somebody did an off by one error somewhere and is just trying to write into the next element. So that might be a thing that it might be configurable to say that, hey, if somebody allocates 48 bytes, do twice as much. So that might make sense. Yeah, David?
If you knew the T, the top of the line, you know, where this comes from, then the size of T might actually be less. Because exactly what you said, if you allocate a factor over 100 elements.
I guess that chip sailed. So David says that if we would know the type of T, because we don't know whether we are allocating 1 T or 100 or 1,000, Then we could make a smarter algorithm, but the problem is that chip has sailed, because in the interface of the allocator of the memory resource, we just have bytes. We don't know what is really being allocated. So fixing. How do we fix it? I will fix two things. One is I don't like here this alignment given by hand. I just don't like it. I made the alignment feature, so I just don't like if people write stuff by hand. Since we are talking about characters, and characters by definition have the alignment of one, it's not a big deal here, but it would be a big deal in a vector, for example. And the other problem is, of course, the length, the number that we are allocating. So how we are going to fix it, we change to another member that is provided by Dietmar and Pablo, which says allocate object, and we say we are allocating characters, so we don't need to anymore give the alignment. And then, well, because we are allocating characters, our size is still the number of bytes. So we are allocating one more than the length so that we have space for the...
But now you know T. The buffer padding.
Yes, but the polymorphic, the memory resource interface, the PMR :: memory resource, the base class, it doesn't have a parameter that says that what is the unit. Yeah, it could have had one. Yeah, that ship has sailed. So we have fixed our constructor and we have fixed our destructor. In the destructor, we use deallocate object because our buffer pointer is not a void pointer but a pointer to chars. It knows that it's chars. This is a template as well, so we don't need to give it the length, we don't need to give it the alignment, it will just take the right alignment. Okay, I need to speed up because I'm half time and I'm not half through the slides. So the next test is we copy the string. Copy constructor is also not written, so this will just copy the bytes, which will, we all know this, yes, I don't have to go into details. So how is it code? So the copied thing will delete what we have allocated, and then the original tries to delete it as well. It goes into the do deallocate of the test resource, and that will say, hey, something is not right here. And about crashing, very shortly, because we are now looking at memory that has been released. In theory, the operating system could have placed there a nice little flag which says, this is not yours anymore. So the moment the test resource tries to look at that memory, that can I delete this, it might crash. So if we have faulty code, our unit test may crash. But that happens with faulty code only. If the code is not faulty, then the test resource itself will not employ any kind of undefined behavior. So the bad code may start crashing when we start using it with the test resource. Maybe before it was silently just doing something that we didn't see it to do anything bad. We install the test resource, it now crashes. So it will either crash or very likely the test resource will detect that something funny is going on. What is the most important thing is that in either case, whether we crash or whether we detect, we have found the bug. So what we do with the test resource is that we make more bugs visible. It is possible to write Machiavelli code that cheats the test resource and the bugs will not be found, but we have not seen code in, at least in my time in Bloomberg, that actually did that. That was just written by people and they made a mistake. So back, how does the double delete that happens here look like? So we can see that something is dead and it's not dead beef anymore because, as I said, we have released this memory and somebody happily overwrote parts of it already. And it says invalid magic number. It doesn't say that it's a double delete. Why? Because that would cost us allocating more memory. We would need to keep track of all the pointers we have ever deleted and look at it and this is deleted. To slow things down. And we never found it necessary. Is it possible to do that? Yeah. That would be a quality of implementation kind of thing for people implementing a test resource to make the engineering trade-off. Do I make it smarter or do I make it faster? So we can see that in the header we have that magic number that is not the magic number that corresponds to an allocated memory block. And somebody overwrote that because this memory was released. The user segment got overwritten as well. And if we have the verbose output, we can see that we have allocated 7 bytes at that address. We have deallocated. This gets printed when the deallocation has been done. It's finished at that address. And then it could have said that this is during deallocation, but all the errors are coming from deallocation. So it's kind of. So we are trying to deallocate that exact same address again. You can also see in the verbose output that we have total allocated 1 memory block and we have tried to delete 2, so that's bad. So we implement the copy constructor. It's important to note that by the idiom of the polymorphic memory allocator, when we are copying, we are not copying the allocator of the source object. We are using either an allocator that is given. You can see this has also a default argument. So we are either using, if no allocator is given, we are using a default, or if an allocator is given, we are using that one, but never the one where it that was in the other object. And then we just do our copy. Okay, let's very quickly look at what things are in this allocator memories. I'm always saying allocator because the two things are interchangeable in the code where we are working. They have been separated in the C++17 standard. So we have a constructor where it was finally made in a way that all constructor arguments are optional. So I can give just name, I can give just the verbosity, I can give just the upstream allocator. So which allocator should it use to allocate the memory? It's probably not going to be this way in the standard because it creates all sorts of overloading and other craziness issues. We have a destructor where we have the leak detection and we have the summary report in verbose mode. We have the doAllocate function which allocates not just the memory, but some more memory around it. It also allocates separate memory so that it can find out if there are leaks. That's the control block. It fills in all the metadata. It writes the magic number, its own address there that, yeah, I have allocated this, the number of bytes, the alignment, and so on. It fills in the padding. A deallocate is where most of the magic happens. And most of the checkings are done. Then we have seen the verbosity, which basically tells whether we print on every allocation, deallocation, and the summary, and then some other. There is nothing on that tablet. And then the quiet is that we can tell to the allocator not to print anything on errors either. So we have these two settings. We have the set abort, set no abort, which we have seen already. These will be probably things that will be replaced during standardization. We have an accessor to the name so that if we want to print something in our own format, we can do that. And we can access what memory resource it uses to allocate its control block and its memory. And the print is printing the same statistics kind of thing that we have seen in verbose mode at destruction. Any question about this? All right. So what are the error statuses? There are mismatches. Mismatch means that you have tried to deallocate the different allocator, basically, which means either bad magic number, which is reported as a mismatch because it might be that it was it didn't have the magic number because it was a double delete, or it didn't have the magic number because it was actually allocated by, I don't know, a new delete resource. Bounds errors is the buffer under an overrun, so when the padding is overwritten. bet the allocation parameter, size or alignment doesn't match with the one that was used at construction. Status is just will just tell us whether this used in the destructor, whether this thing is in a good condition or not. Has allocations is used by status mainly, which basically you can ask that did it leak or not if it's in the destructor. We count the calls to do allocate and do deallocate whether they are successful or not. So this is just number of function calls. We have access source for the last allocated address, number of bytes and alignments, and the last deallocated one as well. I think these are quite obvious. Monitor and guard. So sometimes we want to verify that our design does what we think it does in regards to memory allocation. Like if we push back a long string that requires memory allocation into a vector that is full, has no capacity left, then we know we need to see two allocations. Once for the guts of the vector, we expect the strings inside to be moved, and then another allocation for the string, right? In a well-behaving code. This is what we expect to see. Now, if I do the same pushback again, assuming that now my vector now has excess capacity, so that it allocated big enough space for more than one string, then we will see one allocation only for the string. That's it. So we can do that, but we don't have to be exact because we don't want to make our unit tests fragile. That it, if our specification doesn't promise the number of allocations, then we just will test that, yeah, we have now more allocations than before, or we want to have less allocations than before. Or I don't know, we expect that this was the maximum number of allocations that we ever had, so this had to increase, or maybe we want to just check that there have been any allocations done and maybe also released during this thing or not. Of course, we can do exact things as before if we want to. And we may want to monitor the default resource as well. We will see in the example why, and I'm running now. So we create a test resource as before, we give it a name, and we put a monitor on it. This monitor at this point, it captures the statistics. It makes a copy of all the numbers so that it can later compare. Then we create our string. We check that it allocated. We are still doing the pathetic string. It doesn't have a move constructor defined either. So we can check it either the lazy way, so you wouldn't have both of these, or we can check it the exact way that we have one allocation done, whichever you prefer. Then we reset the monitor. We say that now from this point on, I'm going to move. So from this point, I want to do again, I want to restart the monitoring. I want to start from scratch. We do the move. Observe that because move actually uses the allocator, or supposed to use the allocator of the other object that it moves from, we do not have an allocator or memory resource address argument there, which turns into an allocator. Then we check that and the monitor that there were no allocations. Is total same means the total number of allocations did not change, which means there were no allocations, released or not. We don't care. There mustn't be any allocations. No temporaries, nothing. Problem is that this is not going to fail because this is going to call the copy constructor because there isn't a move one. And because we didn't give the copy constructor an argument, a memory resource argument, it is going to use the default one. And we are not watching the default one. So our test case just passed with a completely broken class. That's not good. So what we are going to do, we are not just going to monitor the object's allocator, but we are going to monitor the default allocator as well. And the way we are going to do that is that we are using a default resource guard, which is in its constructor. It installs this allocator, this resource, the test resource, to be the default resource. And in its destructor, it restores the old one. So whatever was there, we put it back. Because we are in code that allocates memory, there might be exceptions flying all around and so on. So we want really a proper guard class. Then the test code remains the same. It doesn't fit on the slide. We test the objects monitor, and we also check the default resources monitor, which will now fail because we did allocate one. Did it make any sense? And of course, after that, we implement the move, and you can see the implementation in the GitHub repo. Here we are not going to look at that because not important. And we look at the statistics that we can monitor. So in the test resource, we can see the blocks in use and the bytes in use right now. We can look at the total. Again, bytes and blocks. Usually, the blocks are the important ones for us. This is a sum during the lifetime, and the maximum is, of course, the maximum. It can, and both the sum and the maximum can only go up, right? So, in the monitor, we can ask questions: that is the blocks in use up? Is the blocks in use the same, or did it go down? We can ask about the max. Did it go up? Is it the same? And what's the number of change? It cannot go down, so there is no down. Same with the total, can only go up. And yes, there are no byte-based statistics in the monitoring because we simply didn't find any use for it absolutely to monitor them. Because we probably looked at those at the very end, or at that how much was the maximum or something like that, or we have looked at the current values at some point of time. We say that we have I have this container, like I make a rope, right? And this rope has some magic things internally that sort of keep it sane, so it doesn't use much more memory than it needs to. So it kind of packs itself up if it would use. I can check that I know that this rope has a text that is 16 kilobytes, and I can say that I don't want this now to have more than, let's say, 20 kilobytes of memory allocated. So this we found useful, but not monitoring them. The algorithm, and we are flying now. We have 30 minutes left. So. There is an exception, and there is an algorithm that uses it. How does this come together? This is an algorithm, but not in the STL sense, because there are no iterators involved. But it is an algorithm in the sense that it is taking some stuff that it does things with. Like the algorithms, like for each, takes a callable thing. But let's look at this. We will see the code and everything afterwards. So the test resource has a configurable allocation limit, which is number of blocks, number of allocations. So I can tell it zero, which means that the moment you try to allocate something, it throws a test resource exception, which inherits from bad alloc, so that we fool well-written code to think that it's an allocation failure. But it needs to be a different exception because the test loop needs to make a difference between a real out-of-memory situation and an emulated one. Because the real one means that our unit test is screwed. The emulated one means that we need to continue with the loop. So how does this work? Basically, the test loop takes a lambda. It gives the lambda, I will call it a lambda, it can take a you know, anything that is callable. So any type that has an overloaded function call operator, and it gives it a test resource that we give to the loop, and this test resource has it sets its allocation limit first to zero, calls the lambda. The lambda tries to allocate memory, throws an exception. We get out of the lambda, back into the loop. The loop catches that exception. Great, we had an exception. Let's increase the allocation limit now to one. Goes back into the lambda, now it can allocate once. Next allocation, if it has one, will fail, throw an exception, and we go on, go on, go on, until we have done all the allocations that the lambda wanted to do, and it doesn't throw an exception anymore, at which case the test loop says, we are finished. So basically what we have done is that this algorithm makes a properly written code throw exceptions from every possible point where memory allocation can fail. Which means that we can test at least parts of the basic exception safety guarantee, because we can check, because we have a test resource, that it didn't leak. And we can do other tests, as you will see if you know how to. So this thing was invented, discovered, whichever way you go, independently by John Lakos and Dave Abrahams. And these are two pretty big names in C++. So if two very smart people came up with the same idea about the same time, it means that it's probably a useful idea. At least that's how I think about it. So let's look at how does a exception testing test loop code look like. So we need a test resource, right? Because that's what we will be manipulating, or the loop will be manipulating its allocation limit. We need some stuff that we will use. Now here is the loop. It gets the address of the test resource. And here is the head of our lambda, which gets this same test resource as its parameter. And we are capturing the string, whatever, just that we can use it in there. In this lambda, we will just make a deck, push back this same string twice, and that's it. We will do some sanity checking. As I say, it's even if you just test for memory allocation, it makes sense to make a sanity check, like in this case, that what is the size of the deck, so that we see that the code actually did something. Okay. Does this seem like clear? All right. So I'm going to show you how the allocations work inside this deck. And I'm showing you what a library implementation at that time did. But it might be that today that library implementation does something completely different, and other implementations might do something different. So this is just that show you what the output that I have seen and put on the slides represents. So the allocations will be these blue things that you see up here. Allocations will have this color. We will put the code here, and everything that we are looking at is inside the deck, because we only gave, if we look at the code quickly, we inside the lambda, the only thing that we gave the test resource to is the deck. So nothing else matters. We don't care about any temporaries created, anything else, only the parts that is inside the deck. So how does it work? The deck first has to, in its constructor, it does this implementation, which is kind of unique. It has to allocate space for something called a map. Don't mix this up with standard map. This has nothing to do with standard map. It's just a thing that where it keeps track of where do I keep my pieces. Because we know the deck is put together from pieces, like million little vectors. Am I right? Okay. David says I'm right, so okay. Then deck itself inside pushback allocates a string using the allocator that was given to the deck. Why? Because the guys who wrote this deck want to give you strong exception safety guarantee. They say that if this thing doesn't work, I don't want to change my deck's internal structure at all. So they first allocate the string, because we gave them a string which was allocated by the default resource, right? So it uses whatever resource it has to make a string, make a copy, and it only does the rest of it if that copy worked, okay? So suppose copy worked, then it allocates the segment, the first little vector, and then it moves See the trick? It moves when our arrow disappeared. It moves the string inside, then we exit the pushback and the temporary string is gone. And the second thing that I'm showing you is kind of congestion. So I think that this is how it works, but you can't really see it from the output of the program, that it allocates again a temporary string and it moves it back. It might not do it this way when it doesn't need to change the internal structure of the deck. So did it make sense? So there are four allocations, as Captain Picard would say. So these are the four allocations that we will see later on as we go through how the loop works. So here is the loop. I'm showing only the parts. I'm showing all the parts, but you are not supposed to see the gray one. Only the parts that has something to do with memory allocation. This is the end of the lambda, and I should have put this on the separate line, the end of the function call, and this is the end of the scope where we have defined the test resource. These are the points where interesting things will happen. So what happens in the first iteration? Well, not much, because the moment we try to allocate, allocation limit is zero. We try to allocate something that has alignment of four, so that's not a string. That's not the guts of a string, because those are characters. We remember we had allocation of one, alignment of one. This has alignment of four and 28 in size. That's the map of the deck. We couldn't allocate it. We get out of this whole thing. Nothing happens here. Nothing is destroyed because the deck was never created, because we threw an exception from its constructor, right? Second iteration, allocation limit one, we can allocate the map inside the deck, so the map has not been created. We go to the pushback. Inside the pushback, we try to allocate the string alignment one. But because the allocation limit is one and we already have one allocation, sorry, no bonus, exception is thrown. We are getting to the end of the lambda where we are destroying our deck, which is because I was using a real life standard library implementation. It actually works, so it destroys itself and it deallocates the memory. So we are not going to catch any bugs in here. I'm just showing how the loop works. So here are the 1, 2, 3 steps that happen in the second iteration. Third iteration, not so interesting. We can allocate the string as well. Then we cannot allocate the segment. And now, which is not visible from the output, but we know that the actual deallocation, the first one that we see in the listing that you see on the screen, like in your terminal, is coming when we leave pushback, because the string is actually the head of the string, or whatever we call it, is on the stack. So it's deallocated here, then the deck is deallocated there, and we go to the, yeah, this is the order, and we go to the fourth iteration where we can allocate the deck, we can allocate the string, we can allocate the segment, so we now moved the string from the stack into the deck. So now the deck owns the string. We try to allocate the second temporary string. It fails. Now everything is deallocated at the end where the deck is destroyed, because the string that we allocated is owned by the deck. Does it make sense? And the fifth iteration, because we have four allocations, this is the last one, we can just allocate everything. And the string was allocated, moved into the deck, everything is happy. Assertion didn't fail because it works. Everything is deallocated at the end. And basically that's it. The loop will exit because there was no test resource exception thrown. And as the loop exits, we will eventually exit our scope where the test resource was defined, and at the very end, as usual, the test resource in its destructor will check that there are no leaks. So basically, we have tested our deck and strings together for most of the basic exception safety guarantee. This test could be made more granular. We could check in the loop that at the beginning of the loop, we should have zero allocations on our allocator, on our resource, test resource, right? Because we know that everything that we were allocating in the loop should have been destroyed because we didn't do any global things in there. But normally this is enough to find out if something is wrong. Any questions about this? No? Okay. So a little bit back to the purpose. This is a little bit of the sales pitch for the test resource itself. So why do we need the test resource when we have tools that can catch buffer underruns, overruns, leaks, and all these things? First of all, is tools needs to be installed, compiler sanitizers needs to be enabled, every compiler has different kind of options, and so you need to learn all those things. And you need to change your build system for every platform you are working for. If you are working only for Linux with one compiler, then you probably don't care about all these things because you have just one tool to learn. But if you have to support like five operating systems with different compilers, then it becomes interesting. Many tools change the code or actually run the code through emulation to make those checks, which means we are not testing the code that will run in production. And I don't know, I'm picky about that. I want to test the code that I actually deliver to my customer, not something else. Different tools come free with different operating systems with different capabilities. So if you want to be serious, then you will probably have to buy a commercial one, which means licenses, which means logistics of your company gets involved, which means that this will cost not just money, but time. The other thing is that these tools are usually either looking at a whole program or can instrument a translation unit, but they can't give us the granularity of per object what we were doing. And it can also be hard to automate the interpretation of the test results. And with unit tests, we want them to be running fast, we want the test results to be very easy to interpret. So one other thing is that I haven't seen any external tool that is able to support that test exception loop that we have just seen. It might be possible to make them to be able to do that, but I think it would be a very, very difficult task. And maybe it would result in something fragile. Execution can be really, really slowed down. So I have seen a test, these external test tools that made a code 8,000 times slower. Literally, 1,000 times slower, which might be prohibitive for a unit test that needs to run fast. Not to mention that the compilation itself was compilation type was like 5 times more. We are not testing the code that we run in production. We can get false positives that we have to remove because startup code that is written by the Kung Fu guys of the C library writers or C++ library writers who know that I can just allocate this thing and never deallocate it because, you know, it's just going to go away when the process goes away. Those things will show up in a whole program testing. And anytime you get a patch, anytime something changes, those will change and your unit tests just became very fragile, which we don't like. We want our unit tests to be read when there is a bug in our code, right? And we want everyone to do unit tests. And we don't want to wait for this new person 2 weeks until somebody gets a new license that he needs for some tool. And I'm not saying that tools are bad. I'm just saying that for unit testing, they are not the right tool to use. And they can be very, very expensive because if I have to buy something for, I don't know, $25,000 per seat, it doesn't matter whether I need to buy two licenses for the two gurus who might be working in parallel, trying to find something really complicated in a whole program, in a whole application, which really needs what the power what those tools give you and the complexity. Or I have to buy for all the 150 developers a license per seat so that they can run the unit tests. It makes a big difference. So how is it different? Our code runs as fast as normal code that uses PMR would run. So maybe a tiny bit slower than code that directly goes to new, but it's negligible. And as you saw, we have made trade-offs. We are not giving a nice error message when you had a double delete, but in return we use just minimal amount of extra memory and minimal amount of extra CPU. Very easy to use. Can we agree on that? That it was very easy to use? The test results are very easy to interpret. My code either crashed or failed on an assert, or it works. I don't have to go through log files and see that, okay, is this leak mine or not? Integrates into any unit test framework easily. I think that when we change it to be configurable by lambdas or something so that you can bind it into the framework, which I expect that people from the standardization committee will want that, then it will be even more easy to integrate it into a framework. Or maybe not more easy, but more seamless.
When you say integrates into a test framework, it almost sounds like there's something to integrate. There's nothing to integrate. It's just an instance, it's a derived type of an interface. So it's not an integration. It's just
libraries. You are right. It just works out of the box, basically.
Libraries are there's nothing to integrate. But it's no different than the standard library, is what I'm saying.
Well, if it's part of the standard library, then you don't need to.
Most test frameworks I might want to add, make sure no test leaks, for example, so you can easily just install.
Anyway, the point is that right now, to work with any test framework, it will abort your program on a problem which any test runner will interpret as a bug, right? It will be red if your unit test aborts. Do we agree?
Yeah.
And the asserts that you put in, like asserting on the monitors, asserting on like, I shouldn't have had any allocations in all my program from the all my unit tests from the default allocator because I gave allocators to everything. Again, that's just an assertion failure. So it's very, very easy to use it with any test framework, and I'm not going to use the word integration. Requires no change to tested code. And it's not just tested code as in source code, but tested code as in binary. I don't need to change my binary. So if my code is coming as a .o, I can test that. And I'm not saying that now everybody at this very moment should change all of his code that allocates ever to use polymorphic memory resources so that they can use the test resource. John maybe will say that, I will not. What I will say is that this is something that if you have polymorphic memory resources used in your code, then testing of that behavior, memory allocating behavior and such, will become very, very easy compared to not having it. So applicability, when can you use the test resource? We have to be open about this. If you are making a standard library implementation, because the standard library implementation by definition has to support C++ 11 allocators, which by definition supports polymorphic allocator, which by definition supports polymorphic memory resources, which the test resource is, you can use it. You don't need to do anything extra. You can just use it. If you are making an STL compliant container and you make it allocator aware because you want to make it look like the STL, like you make a rope or this tree which nobody knows how to pronounce properly so that it doesn't sound like tree. Some people say it's, you should say it's try, and now people say no, I don't know. So if you want to do any of these and you make it allocator aware, which is probably a good idea, looking at John's talk, because this is a very low level component. So you can give an awful lot of benefits to the people above you if you make it allocator aware. You can use just the same way as you can use the test resource with your standard library implementation. However, if you decide not to make your code first class, not even business class, but you say, I'm flying, what is it called? Premium economy. Then you can just directly use the memory resource or directly use the polymorphic allocator, how I used it in the pathetic string or broken string class. And you didn't have to make your type necessarily into a template, or maybe it's a template, but you didn't have to deal with all the craziness that comes with the C++ 11 allocators. Does it propagate and copy? Does it not? Should I do this? Should I do that? No, you don't have to go into all those details. You can just use this directly. You can still use the test resource with your code, because you have put in the customization point. That's the important thing. Enhancement ideas is just some things that came up, not very interesting, but ideas that we might be considered, or I have a feeling that they might come up during standardization, is we right now do not check the integrity of leaked blocks. So we don't look at the padding of leaked blocks on destruction. Maybe people want that. It will require use of more memory if we do so. Here is one which we just discovered, that now that we get the alignment, the original test allocator in Bloomberg, it returns as every allocator the maximum fundamental alignment. But right now we get an alignment, and our test allocator, a test resource implementation right now, doesn't play with that pointer that it returns, so that it's the weakest address or the weakest allocation that satisfies the one that you asked. So for example, when I return a pointer, you ask for me for a string that with the alignment of 1. Right now I return something that has an alignment of 8. I should add +1 or do a -1, because probably want more padding at the end, because buffer overruns are much more frequent than buffer underruns. So I should start going backwards with this pointer, so it will actually not have the alignment. And why is it important? Because if you are working on ARM or something, that means that if I returned alignment 1, but you were allocating a double, then your ARM CPU will crash the moment you try to touch this as a double, right? On x86, you will not really see anything. It will not even slow down. It will just do whatever. On Spark, I think it might slow down considerably. In one setting of the compiler and in another setting, it crashes with bus error. So that's one thing. Callbacks may be considered to be added so that you can actually integrate it into a test framework, so that it knows about the test framework. So for example, a destructor can tell to the test framework to give a test framework specific error message rather than something else. Strong exception safety test loop. We can do the basic one. We are thinking about the strong one. That can be added as a completely separate step, so it doesn't have to delay anything. We could put a CRC on the metadata so that we can look at that block, not only look at the magic number, but also the CRC. Again, it would use more memory, it would use more CPU. Is it worth it? not probably not for unit tests, but some people like to use this test resource or our test allocator for whole programs when they just give up looking for leaks or problems, by hand. Configurable deallocate later. This would allow us to give nicer errors about double deletes, but it would use more memory. Like we would say that we don't deallocate the last 50 blocks. In a unit test, we could even say we don't deallocate anything. We could just keep it until the end because it's probably not using that much memory. It's a possibility. It's with a question mark. We didn't find it necessary. In C++ plenty, we will have stack information. Could it be added? Yes, but it would use a lot more memory. Because then we could say that, hey, you have didn't deallocate this thing. And by the way, this is the source line where you allocated it. And this was the call stack. And the code is at GitHub under the Bloomberg namespace. And basically, this is the end of it. And we have like 2 minutes, 40 seconds left for tangents, comments, all those things. Yes?
I probably missed it, but just to confirm that through the resource chaining, it's possible to chain in a resource behind the test resource that, for example, in our use case, we have test resources that provide specific pieces of data to drive our tests. But it'd be nice to be able to tag, to chain that in as the provider resource for test resource and other counters on top.
You can. The one thing I didn't mention, the test resource is a special resource. When you create a test resource, it's not using the default resource as its default. It's behind the scenes. The implementation right now uses malloc and free. Why is not using the default? Because I'm monitoring the default. Default might already be a test resource, and it will just say, hey, you allocated 600 times. I'm like, from where? So yeah, you can give it a test resource, any kind of test resource you want. You just need to understand that whatever you put there will add to the cost. So if it does something additional, it will sort of, one of the important things, and that's the other reason why we are using malloc and free inside here, is that we are trying to use, like, the implementation uses printf instead of streams and all these things. We are trying to have the least effect on the system. So for example, that's why I think that when we put this into the standard, right now this is thread safe. We will have to have two of them. One is not thread safe, the other one is thread safe. Or configurable, something like that. But so to that we can make the least effect on the system because we don't want to change the behavior of the system too much just because we are testing it, because then we get the Heisenberg effect, right? Any other question, comment? All right. So my message is that please do go to GitHub, take a look at there. You will find their pathetic string. You will find there the test loop with the deck. And by the way, it's a deck because the vector implementation of that specific standard library I was using was actually allocating in a no except constructor. And that didn't play well with the test loop, which was throwing an exception on that very first allocation in the debug mode, if everything was configured for release. Anyway, that's just an interesting thing. So please do look at it and play with it and give us feedback, because that's the reason why we do all these things, is to get feedback. Thank you.